Deputy Governor of the Central Bank, Mr. Elson Gaskin. Keynote Speaker, Dr. Anthony Joseph. Dr. Yvonne Weeks, Chairperson of the Frank Collymore Literary Endowment Committee. Stephen Brathwaite, Manager of Frank Collymore Hall and members of the Frank Collymore Literary Endowment Committee. Staff of the Central Bank of Barbados, specially invited guests, writers, readers, and arts enthusiasts. Media, ladies and gentlemen, friends all. Good evening, and welcome to the 26th awards ceremony of the Frank Collymore Literary Endowment. I am DeCarla Applewaite, your Master of Ceremonies for this celebratory evening. 2023, not as much as 2022, was a tumultuous year, evolving out of the woeful time of the pandemic to one of celebration, like a new dawn in spring, as Barbados celebrated its first year as a republic, shaping its 57th year of independence, and one of sorrow, as the literary community lost some of its membership to the Library in the Sky. I would like for us to take a moment to remember those who passed last year. In particular, Montserratian playwright and novelist Edgar Nkosi White, Norvan Fullerton, founder and artistic director of Malik of Trinidad and Tobago, and Arsonia Williams. A multi-award winner of the Frank Collymore Literary Endowment, thespian, Pan-Africanist, sage, griot, writer, friend of many here tonight. If you could all please stand for a moment's silence and reflection. Thank you all. Please sit. Paying tribute to Sonia, reading from her 2019 third placing manuscript On Liberty, a piece she dedicated to Louise Paris, The Last Embrace, read by friend and sister Titu Heron.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and anyone in between. It's really ironic. Most of the time I'm sitting in the crowd, so the only thing I can say is, look what Sonia do. It's the first time I'm actually reading on this stage, and I'm also honored that I've been asked to read one of her pieces. The Last Embrace. For Louise Paris, you left in your time. It is enough, you said. It is enough. You let go of the sucking long heave to breathe, of bones, muscles loose in hanging, skin heavy, too heavy to lift, but light enough to fly away. You did not want to talk anymore the day before. You rested. I sat guarding your body while your spirit flew, unaware you were not lying there till you returned. It was peaceful, you said. You saw your mother and father. Cold feet, so cold, your body shivering, covered with sheets. I crawled under, arms around you, holding on to hope. If I had held onto you close enough, we would have conceived. It would have been immaculate. I would have carried you here, right here, in the heart of heart, to be born again. Sonia Williams, thank you.
Thank you, Tito. And with every email she ever sent, she closed with the sentiment, what good? What good, Sonia? What good? To bring warm words of welcome to this evening's celebration, I invite Mr. Elson Gaskin, Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Barbados. Mr. Gaskin?
Ladies and gentlemen, I trust you indulge me on this one occasion to adopt the protocol so ably established by our Master of Ceremonies, DiCarlo, and simply say good evening. In commencing, let me, on behalf of the Governor, Board, Management, and Staff of the Central Bank of Barbados, extend deepest condolences to the family, friends, and loved ones of the late Sonia Williams, who, on more than one occasion, was a finalist in this competition. As I began to prepare for this awards ceremony, I looked back at what we've said on previous occasions, as it is sometimes important to take a retrospect before moving forward. What stood out during that exercise is that we have spoken about the role that the arts play in creating a national identity. Just last year, we spoke about the fact that not only has the Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment, that not only is it a part of the bank's legacy, it has created a legacy of its own. The Central Bank of Barbados's unswerving support for and commitment to the Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment is precisely because we recognize that in addition to fulfilling our core mandate, we must be a part of and never apart from the society we serve. We see this program as an essential part of the Barbadiana that we all are. A year ago, the bank was winding down its 50th anniversary celebrations, and the Literary Endowment was marking its silver jubilee. The parallels between the two institutions, and I do not choose this word lightly, because the Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment has become an institution, and therefore the parallels between us extend beyond celebrating milestone anniversaries around the same time. Both institutions are interested in Barbados's national development. The bank, that is primarily but not exclusively related to the economy. But the Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment is about the development of this island's literary tradition. It is a role we both take seriously and from which comes a second parallel, our respective commitment to excellence. The Central Bank of Barbados's vision is to become and maintain an institution of world-class excellence. And we are working every day to internalize this vision and reflect it not only in the many activities in which we are involved, but also in the quality with which we execute these activities. I am confident that the Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment and its committee also live by this ideal. Over the past 26 years, the competition has become a bellwether of quality writing. Publishers, critics, and the public at large see winning this competition as an endorsement. I therefore commend the judges for remaining faithful to these ideals and never compromising in their assessment of entries. The final parallel I'd like to draw relates to how we view our legacy. While the bank and the Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment has each created a legacy, we are not constrained by it. By that, I mean that although we respect the legacy we've built, we do not see it as static. Rather, we see it as a solid foundation to be further built upon. For the bank, this includes updating our processes, including through the digital transformation we are currently undergoing. It also means adjusting how we approach fulfilling our mandate, be it through developing a strong monetary policy toolkit, or finding new and creative ways to educate the public about the economy and how it impacts them. And you would have seen our recent web and television series in this regard, that being called the Explainer series. For the Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment, this has meant allowing for the electronic submission of entries and by extension, accepting entries from the Barbadians in the diaspora. In less than 3 years, this expansion has proved successful, with Ronald Williams, a US-based writer, emerging as the first prize winner in the 24th edition of the competition in 2022. This year, the Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment has innovated again by introducing a spoken word category. This once again opens up the competition to more artists, more perspectives, and more opportunities for talented Barbadians to gain exposure. We therefore extend kudos to the committee for this initiative. Indeed, I want to convey my appreciation and the Central Bank of Barbados' appreciation as sponsor of this endowment to the Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment Committee, now ably led by Dr. Yvonne Reeves. We wish to commend you for your enthusiasm and tireless dedication to this program. The bank has long been a supporter of the arts, and you've helped us to contribute to their development in a tangible way. I must also thank the writers, the stalwarts, who have contributed to the legacy I've spoken about this evening, and the first-time entrants who heard about this competition, saw its value, and decided to participate. A special thank you to the spoken word artists who, by their entries, have helped us to add a new dimension to the competition. Congratulations to those of you who will emerge winners later this evening, and those of you for whom this is not the year, I nevertheless encourage you to continue to write and hone your craft. Finally, I'm grateful to you, the audience who have turned out this evening, either to support specific writers in particular or Barbadian writing in general. I therefore thank you and say welcome.
Thank you, Elson, for your warm and inspiring words of and support of the Literary Endowment and the continued commitment by the Central Bank in the development and evolution of the literary arts and keeping the legacy of Frank Cullimore alive, and the appreciation and the importance of arts and culture in the development of a nation from this towering building over Barbados. Thank you so much. Earlier today, we had a fantastic literary learning experience with our featured speaker tonight. It is always a busy award weekend, and the work of the committee is never done, as we are always finding ways and the best opportunities to engage the literary community. Our keynote, Dr. Anthony Joseph, is an award-winning Trinidad-born, London-based poet, novelist, musician, and academic. He is the author of 4 poetry collections and 3 novels. His 2018 novel, Kitsch, a fictional biography of a Calypso icon, was shortlisted for the Republic of Consciousness Prize, the Royal Society of Literature's Encore Award, and longlisted for the OCM Booker's Prize for Caribbean Literature. His most recent fiction publication is the experimental novel, The Frequency of Magic, which received an Arts Council of England Touring Award. As a musician, he has released 8 critically acclaimed albums, and in 2020 received a Paul Hamlin Foundation Composers Award. He holds a PhD in creative writing from Goldsmiths College and has taught at Birkbeck College, Goldsmiths, and at the University of Liverpool. He and the chair met online when he spoke with last year's long-listed Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment awardees. She immediately went to find his last collection of poems, Sonnets for Albert, which won the T.S. Eliot Prize for Poetry in 2022. Since then, she has encouraged us all the pleasure of reading many of those poems. The weight of the memories of his father as the poems bring him back to life evoked such emotions while we've been all reading. Chair wept. Ladies and gentlemen, our keynote speaker, Anthony Joseph. Sir?
Thank you. I got to say thank you, first of all, to Yvonne Weeks and her team for getting me here. The title of my keynote is The Work of Words Beyond Language. So what I want to do is to speak about language via two entry points for me personally into Barbados. So my previous visits here have been transient, mostly consisting of traveling to Trinidad and having stopovers here, and then going on to the UK or moving back and forth. But in 2017, I arrived here after Carnival, I think like the Wednesday morning after Carnival, and I got here really early on like the first flight. And I was lucky enough to have a full day in Barbados before the flight to London that evening. And with a day in Barbados, I did what, you know, what else was there to do but go to the beach. I went to the beach, I had a bath, I had some cuckoo and some fish. And that was the longest time I spent here previously, at least physically. There are a couple more profound entry points into Barbados for me as a poet, points where the island and its literature have had a lasting and direct impact on my work, on my aesthetic consciousness. And that's what I want to talk about tonight, threaded through with a focus on language. So the first entry is, in 1978, I started secondary school in Trinidad. I'd started writing poetry in September that year, pretty much in those first weeks of secondary school. I remember the day, I remember the moment I started writing poetry. I'd grown up immersed in calypso and, you know, Caribbean music, in the music of the Mighty Sparrow and Lord Kitchener, Lord Shorty, and also in reggae and American pop music. And I was fascinated mostly, I think the thing which fascinated me the most about music at that point was the lyrics. So I started writing what I thought was song lyrics, but which actually turned out to be the beginning of a poetic practice. And this coincided with a more formal study of poetry in secondary school. Mr. Thomas was the teacher. He was one of those teachers that changes your life. Everyone has one. He was an amazing teacher, but he was very, very, very strict. So strict that you would get licks if you misbehaved in his class or if you didn't do your homework. In fact, I think Mr. Thomas was generally in charge of sharing licks to the whole school. We feared him. But it was Mr. Thomas who inspired me to read closely and to really fall in love with poetry. Our poetry textbook was a book called Bite In, Stage One. I don't know if you have the same books here, but we used a book called Bite In, Stage One, which was an anthology that was edited by Cecil Gray. And Gray, as you know, was a Trinidadian poet and educator who was significantly responsible for the introduction and integration of Caribbean literature into our official studies through the CXE. Bighton, though, was a very, I think, as I remember, it was a very strange, eclectic collection of poems. There were poems by Indian poets. There were poems by children. There were poems by Afro-American poets. There were poems by English writers like Auden and Blake, West African poets like John Pepper Clark, and of course, poets from the Caribbean. So we had a chance at that early stage, at that early age, to read cross-culturally, cross-historically, to discover and to compare a wide range of voices, and also to see the commonalities between the poems. It became possible to understand what a poem was and how poetry worked. And I think that this rich variety in the collection was a form of revolutionary thinking on the part of Gray. Having all those poems and voices juxtaposed in this way meant that the work of poetry, which I think lies in drawing the reader into themselves, by isolating a moment, an idea, or an image and distilling it in a way which encourages a new way of seeing, feeling, and saying was made clear. And this too is the work of language, and this is the work of the poet who uses language. And in a way, it's not really about the notes that are played, but the music that is ultimately produced. But here's the thing, right? In Byton, there were 70 poems. Roughly half of those poems were by Caribbean poets. And of the Caribbean poems, only one deviated from standard English lexicon. Standard English syntax. Of all these poets, only one deviated, and that was Louise Bennett, who had a poem in there called Colonization in Reverse. The other poems all used standard English. And I think as students, what we understood from that was that English was the diction of poetry. It was the language of poetry. And so, if we were to judge from the poems in Byton, it meant that Caribbean writers were equally adept at it. And so, we were equal to poets everywhere. What made the Caribbean poems distinct was the occasional mention of a specific location or some sort of cultural artifact which we could recognize. But of course, I'm being kind of naive and kind of simplistic and reductionist about it. It's much more complex than that. I became aware, of course, as I read more of the politics of language, of the complexities of imperial languages and nation language, the creolizing effect. And a lot of these dichotomies were being played out in the Calypso and in the wider post-independence society. And even in our homes, there was this struggle between proper English and yard language, or whatever you choose to call it. But as a young poet, I was more intrigued by what the poems in Byton communicated, the emotions and the stories and the images they captured. My favorite poem in the anthology was a poem called At 13 by Frank Collymore. And I say that not because of where we are, although that's pretty cool. I say it because of all the poems I'd read so far at that age, that poem seemed to speak directly to me, or at least through me. Like the narrator, I too was 13, and I too had started to have these baroque, grand, romantic ideas. And I could relate to the imagery of the poem. I could see every corner of the seascape. I could see the sea, the sand, the trees in the poem. I knew the inner sense of it at 13. You were a princess then on a golden throne, though you never knew you were my own. For I rescued you from death by fire a score of times and from drowning many more. Saved you from pirates, we were shipwrecked on a lonely island whose shores were decked with the pearls and gold the sea had restored. From lost galleons, a schoolboy's hoard to pay. Sometimes I even died for your sake. Then you came to my side and held my hand, and my grateful ghost hovering there saw your tears and knew how sweet was the final cost, and watched over you all your mourning years. We could situate Frank Collymore's poem within a kind of colonial aesthetic, right? We can place it in a kind of mimicry that was common in a lot of Caribbean writers of the 1940s when I believe At 13 was written. After all, this was the colonial period, and the formal education we were afforded in the English-speaking Caribbean was decidedly and canonically English. So there's a kind of Keatsian romanticism at work in Collymore's sonnet, a kind of Victorian approach to imagery and form, even if the location is Caribbean. We could draw on Fanon and locate the poem within a kind of what Fanon calls an unqualified assimilation. At the first phase of what Fanon saw as the evolution of the native intellectual or artist, in which, to quote Fanon, the native intellectual gives proof that he has assimilated the culture of the occupying powers. His writings correspond point by point with those of his opposite numbers in the mother country. His inspiration is European, and we can easily link up these works with definite trends in the literature of the mother country. But an equally important question for me, at least, would be, does the poem do the work of poetry? Does it communicate its truth? Does it do this regardless of its diction? Yes, we can say that Collymore's poem is written in an imperial language of a colonizer, but can we even say this? Derek Walcott reminds us that the English language is nobody's special property. It is the property of the imagination. It is the property of the language itself. And I agree with that. And so, Frank Collymore's main responsibility here in writing at 13, I think, is to write well, which he does. My focus here, though, is not on clinically analyzing that space between the colonial and the post-colonial. That's been done. I will suggest that there is validity to both sides of the fence, and perhaps it's not even an argument at all whether a Caribbean writer should write in any particular way, or whether we should consider early Caribbean writing like Collymore's or literature of the 30s and the 20s and the 30s as somehow derivative. We have to look, I think, beyond language. I think the task of the poet is to find a voice which is uniquely theirs, to create a self-sufficient universe of language, a literature which explores the interstices of language to find a certain truth of human experience. And this brings me to my second entry into Barbados, Kemal. In 2004, my friend, Professor Laurie Shire, presented some of the work from my second collection as part of a paper on avant-garde Black British writing at a conference in California. Kemal Braithwaite was in the audience and spoke to Laurie afterwards about what he'd heard. According to Laurie, he came up to her and said something like, "The boy have it." And soon after, Laurie introduced us by email, and Kemal and I started corresponding. We met in person for the first time in May the following year. He was in London. He was staying at a place called Good Enough College. It's an interesting name, Good Enough College, near Bloomsbury. We had lunch, it sounds fancy. I had lunch with Kemal Braithwaite, but it was actually bread and lentil soup. And we spoke about poetry. In fact, he mainly asked me about my work and made me do all the talking, and he listened to my responses. And when I said that I found myself writing more then about Trinidad, after having been in London for 6 years at that point, he said, "Well, you don't really become a Caribbean poet until you leave the Caribbean." And this is a theme that both George Lamming and Stuart Hall, among many others, have expanded upon. But that day, that was the first time I'd heard someone say that. And something in that simple sentence from Kemal resonated deeply. It was pivotal, it was personal, and it helped me to understand on an intimate level what being a diasporic Caribbean writer meant. I drew a kind of validity from it, and I knew then that I was a Caribbean writer. So there was no longer, "I'm a poet, I'm just a poet," I knew I was a Caribbean poet. It was the first of many of what I call deep teachings, where an elder scholar opens a portal in your mind in a really deceptively simple way. And I was fortunate to receive a few from Kemal over the years. In about 2007, I asked him which poets had influenced his writing. And I expected him to say Blake, or at least Keats. Maybe Robert Hayden, Marion Moore, Yeats. I knew that he'd acknowledge that the tone, cadence, and organization of Eliot had been, in his words, the only European influence he could detect in an interview with Gordon Rohe in 1981. But what came out said to me that day was kind of different. He said, well, when I was growing up in Barbados, there was a carpenter who had a shop on the corner, and he was carving a map of Africa, and I would go there and we would talk. And then there was my father and my mother. There were no writers mentioned. No matter how I pushed him, it was more family and friends. And this completely changed my understanding of what influence really was. And it changed the way I would answer that question when people asked me. What makes you a poet first, I think, is in part your understanding or your misunderstanding of language. And this happens in early childhood. So you kind of become, you start to think like a poet at a really early age, before you start to read all these big poets. This is the foundation which is then built upon by reading and scholarship. But I learned much more from my father or from leader Jimmy the Baptist preacher when I was 7 than I would ever learn from reading Allen Ginsberg or Emily Dickinson. By the time I encountered writers like that, I was already a poet. I was just looking to build on what I already had. And this is something that Kimau taught me. The third deep teaching from Kimau is simply a lesson in forging a unique idiosyncratic voice from the elements of an imperial language, English lexicon, and West African syntax, from the rhythm of nation language into the creation of a singular yet universal expression. I'm talking of his work from the Arrivance onwards, when the syntax and grammatology becomes more expansive and original in its form and its sonic arrangement. This experimentation is the work of the poet, as it is for the musician. Whether John Coltrane, who Kimau adored, is playing Nature Boy or Ascension, we still know it's John Coltrane. Earl Lovelace once told me, in another deep teaching, just as an aside, that the task of the writer was to be human, not to be eccentric or technically brilliant. We were talking about V.S. Naipaul. What we hear in Kimau is something beyond language. His is a singular voice, that of a poet who, through the mastery of language, and the mastery in his case sometimes includes dismantling the language disrespectfully, a writer who finds the tool to transcend the national or the historical and is able, through a form of alchemy, to approach a deep expression of being and bearing witness. This is often the place where language breaks. As when he writes, them find two dead fish lay out in the plate of his white tongue without language, all their syllables of living color and career through the water, all this gone. This space in which we experience a brief cognitive dissonance, this magic, is what all poets should be striving for. It's what I believe Kimau found through a dedication to heritage and truth. It's what I strive for in my own work, constantly searching for what I call the frequency of magic, that place where magic occurs, where the real work of the poem occurs, which is often a place that is between the beats, where you least expect it. A writer finds this magical voice by being curious about the gaps in language, the places where language falls and fails, the places where you are propelled and compelled to say something, but you don't have the words or the syntax, but you're writing so fast that you just let the words hit the page as they come. One day, I wrote, birds and their talons have sea in their sadness and sky in the roofs of their mouth. I was writing a poem about my grandmother, and it was as if the universe had looked at me and said, okay, you've been writing this poetry thing for so long. All right, take a poem, have a poem. And the universe just gave me a poem. I didn't have to do much editing. It expressed something really true to the vision, even though the language caused these unpredictable gaps in understanding. And I think that's what poets are striving for, a place where this magic happens. In his Nobel Prize acceptance speech, Derek Walcott says, "Antillean art is this restoration of our shattered histories, our shards of vocabulary, our archipelago becoming a synonym for pieces broken off from the original continent. And this is the process of the making of poetry, or what should be called not its making, but its remaking, the fragmented memory. This remaking is what creates a self-sufficiency in the canon, and it redefines what a poem can do. It pushes things a little bit forward." Kemal's language is often liminal. It is not something fixed into form. It is a language of becoming. It is neither standard English or Creole, not something in between, but something different altogether. It is not Homi Bhabha's hybrid. It is not a fusion. It is something original, something personal, and so something universal, because the personal is the universal. It is also a tool for revolutionary action, since in the history of the voice, he reminds us that it was in language that the slave was perhaps most successfully imprisoned by his master, and it was in his misuse of it that he perhaps most effectively rebelled. In Kemal's poetics, there is Africa in its eye, in its spiritual temple, in its syntax. There is Europe in its lexicon, even though that gets disrupted by his sycorax. And there is the repeated quantum effect of the creolizing impulse. The Caribbean is everywhere. But there is most importantly something specific to his own experience of language, that liminal space where the personal encounters the political. And this is what Fanon identified as the third or fighting stage, the final stage in the evolution of the native intellectual, where the writer becomes an awakener of the people, creating a fighting literature, a revolutionary literature, a national literature, to compose the sentence which expresses the heart of the people. And this is what I think we're working towards. It's a tall task, but this is what I think as Caribbean writers we are working towards. So we've evolved through those stages, the first stage, the second stage, and now we're on the third stage, I think, where we are making and remaking and reassembling ourselves, not as a homogeneous group, but as a personal integration, interrogation through layers of the self. I actually think that this is relevant to all writers, not just poets, not just Caribbean poets even, to all writers. A writer must become intimately and deeply invested in the practice. Anything will give up its secrets if you love it enough, even language, beyond language. I want to close with a poem that I wrote for Kemal. It's one of two poems that I've dedicated to him over the years. I started writing it on the night that I learned of his passing, and I finished it in a few days after. But it was one of those things that just came. There was very little editing. There's a version of it with my band on the last album that we released a couple of years back, which you can find on YouTube, and which features Shebaka Hutchings on saxophone, but this is the poem, Kemau. For Kemau, for the furtive sound of his photo aesthetic exegesis, for his liquid technology, his secret technology, the sepi, pure energy, seducing the air, lancing the plane of sight. And if vision is righteous and holy and pure, then Baba, you were the sonic sage, the one who never kept silent, the one who never wear necktie yet, the one who never knelt and wept in pews, the one who wove beads of triplet notes with the trumpet in his throat, the infinite muse, a bad and contagious poet, perceptible only in a glance, inevitable, emerging, dressed in black, much blacker than black, surrealist conflict. And I've been a black surrealist ever since I saw my grandfather chuck the wheel of his Austin Cambridge with a rock so it don't roll downhill and simple into the sea because iron don't float. Since I ran between vine and root, I leapt over the wire where the land rushed wild onto the sea. I picked the fruit still warm from the vine. So much hairy snake and pickerbush was tying up the land. Come on, flash your costume, flash your rage, poet. Play sailor mass, play jab jab, play junkanoo, play rokotuk music. Play with fife and bones and fiddle and flute. Play moko jambi, dance the juba with the hands akimbo. Play stick man and bust the carapace. Play mud mass, plot your route, piss blood, piss rum, wear the brazen breastplate and the burnt wooden mask from the upper volta. Wear pins in the mouth like a tailor carving a map of Africa on the corner of an island. Play kaiso, play calypso, play socalypso, play rapso, play jazz like a second skin. Reel you in, reel you in. And I carried my black surrealist manifesto between elbows like fetish to poison wounds in the bronze plateau of the Congo. Read me in, Brooklyn warehouse space. No running water, no hot heat, no light, but for none, for none, for none, for none. Read you in, read you in. I read you in every squall and ball of the hurricane. Write this in the distance. Write this on the wind. Write this on the waves. Write this in fragments under islands. Write this in each trace of diaspora. May you return, if possible, as a gray-bearded Afronaut. Emerge again as a secret color. Emerge again, deep teacher, as wizard, as hawk or blackbird, as if you fell from the stars or emerged from the rainforest hole. Come on, swing your horn and flash your second skin. Flail and flash your color. Omen, omen, omen of Jambi, Siaman, Obiaman, Obiaman who can make remote vision of people with psycho-spiritual camera and then the next day tell you what you was wearing, what bone you was chewing at your kitchen table the night before. Come on, cast speaking serpents out. Flash your beacon, be bold, be something else. And on the first day of the first week of the first month of the first year after your death, we come with real, real fire this year. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Dr. Joseph. You left us on a high. You took us on a journey and we followed. Thank you. Thank you for continuing to inspire us. And no matter, Yvonne, you would know this, no matter the temperatures or the climes, be creative. May your words warm you wherever you go and define you as Caribbean. May your insight continue to guide our creativity and philosophy. Thank you. Another round of applause for Dr. Joseph. What a fantastic segue to our next part of our program. As spoken to by Mr. Gaskin, in our 26th year, the committee was pleased to innovate and extend the reach of the endowment work, not only awarding exciting work, but the introduction of a spoken word component, formally recognizing the oral tradition of the diaspora. In this inaugural year, tonight, you will hear from two of the finalists, LaShawna Griffith and Akeem Prescott Chandler. Please welcome each of them.
It's unspoken about in every aspect of society. The way the color of your skin determines if you pretty or ugly. If you light skin or dark skin. If you dark as night or if you just black and dull. And trust me, colorism in Barbados real strong. No one likes to talk about it. How the color of your skin can determine your fate, and if the woman at the restaurant would put you to sit at the back, or better yet, put you to sit at the front, but be sure to ask aloud, how you paying for this meal, by cash or by card? Call people like you. Scratch that, people like we cannot afford to pay for a meal where the only currency is white privilege. We talk about colorism in a whisper, almost like it's a secret that can't be verbalized, a stain on the tip of the tongue, twirling around, hoping to slip down. But the rules of colorism are very simple, so simple that I wrote them in this handbook I like to call Colorism 101. Chapter 1, ensure that the plantation model is apparent in every aspect of society. Let persons visiting a 98% black country only see white persons in each hotel. And let all the heads of tourism be white. And if, just if, anyone happens to object, just place a black chairman. Let them do all the heavy lifting while we continue to lift in the system of servitude and economic cleansing. And if that doesn't work, head to chapter 2. Make the black girl feel as though she isn't beautiful because she doesn't meet the European standards of beauty. Ensure she's taught it from a young age by giving her a white Barbie whose image she'll idolize and worship. And without knowing it, she begin to loathe her own skin because according to them, it isn't perfect. So she do anything to fix it. So she goes under the knife and reconstructs her face without facing her insecurities, because it's easier to hide behind plastic than it is to admit the truth that you're a victim of the European standards of beauty. But if that doesn't work, head to chapter 3. Take the black man and constantly show him that black men are only wanted for their bodies. And that without it, they'll be undesirable. Constantly show it in movies that black men are mere tools for sexual gratification. Make their features so unappealing, so that a little black girl always wants a Prince Charming, never someone who's not charmed in. You ever wonder why in each storybook the princes are white, but the aggressors are black? Ever wonder what's the reason? But that's a chapter 4 hack, and we don't even need to discuss that. In chapter 5, we tell our young girls that their princes are white Persians and that no black men are ever coming to save them. We tell our black boys that the only storybook where they're depicted, wild jungle boy Tarzan, that it takes a special kind of woman to love them. And more often than not, it's some unassuming white woman who's infatuated with their physical structure. But if that doesn't work, head to chapter 6. Make them use skin lighteners. Make them affordable. Tell them that they can finally have what their heart desires, because their original complexion, only a mother could love. And she heartbreaking, because their original complexion, only a mother could love. But she heartbreaking. And if that doesn't work, create a subculture in each ghetto of persons who have done it successfully. Let them be martyrs of the bleaching industry, cause we all want to be pretty, right? We all want to be pretty, right? And if that doesn't work, head to chapter 7. Make them sing God Save the Queen and be able to name all of the British royal family. I never utter a bad word against that family because it's the diplomatic thing to do. Silence their quest for anti-colonialism by showing them that there was one black bishop at the king's swearing-in ceremony where they wore the royal jewels that they raped and robbed our nations for. It sure is highly publicized on social media that the royal family is the epitome of the money earned from our ancestors. And if that doesn't work, head to chapter 8. Make the black man feel bad by making the system elitist. Tell him that his best is not good enough. Give him an inferiority complex, like it's a multivitamin, and add a little victim mentality to balance out that concoction. And if that doesn't work, head to chapter 9. In this chapter, we praise all things European and hope that the king always rules. Because who doesn't love a story of stolen legacies and bloody diamonds and full irony? So this chapter is here for everyone to see as we sing God Save Our Gracious Queen. Ignoring the Union Jack, no bleeding blue, yellow and black from our palms, cause we all want to marry a prince, right? But if that doesn't work, head to chapter 10. Ensure this chapter is implemented with pristine precision. Ensure that race is taught in every aspect of society and that blacks continue to earn minimum wage and tax them so much they resort to crime to live. Let a little black girl know that it's easier to own the OnlyFans than it is to own a legitimate business. Let a little black girl know that the possibility of her fulfilling her dreams is as small as a white man ever paying reparations. And when she gets mad at the system, and when the system drives her mad, just remind her that the world isn't based on color. Just some of us get to manufacture the crayons. Chapter ends.
In the summer, black boys are baptized by bullets. They bathe in blasphemy when the OG says blast. For me, in the summer, bones can break like bread in communion. And I've seen a union of boy and and God. Boy meets Heavenly Father before he gets to know his earthly one. Boy becomes pilot to another plane of existence. Boy flies off the handle. In the summer, the streets are hot and black boys bald tempers on their head top. It really ain't you selling a hot head, big man cool out. Cause once he take that tool out, he willing to fix that problem for good. Trigger finger itching to scratch you off the senses. This pent up frustration is fossilized. Black boy becomes crustacean and never comes out of his shell. As black men, we tend to struggle with mental health. But knowing black men, we can probably attribute that to something else. We assert our stance that we are a product of circumstance, and we never extend the olive branch to our family tree. As black men, we often reject peace. We know there's snakes in the grass, but we refuse to cut the weeds. We find therapy in a 10-piece, and we attend the sessions daily like... Black boy is a walking distraction. He's writing a diss track to the heartbeat of the city, with police sirens for the melodies and traffic clogging the arteries. Black boy pumps a fist to resuscitate the dead ideology. Black boy, it's 1937, he's a riot winner to happen. Black boys are baptized by bullets in the summer, but this black boy knows that oppression is the only true weapon. You see, when you wear your mourning colors on your skin, you can make anything into a funeral. You can make memory into memorial in a millisecond. Your distance from death is less than 9 millimeters. You're either a statistic or an exception, a selection from a pool of muddy policies. Black boy is poverty personified, a country pillaged by privileged paupers, poor in morals but rich in malice. Black boy is a tragic story breaking every 8 o'clock. Black boy is not student, he's a token of diversity for college university. Black boy is black first, and boy, maybe. How many black men become ATMs the moment they become fathers? Their accounts balance on a tight rope, tiptoeing with caution. How often do we hear the phrase, "You shouldn't applaud a fish for swimming"? If we're great black fathers, we aren't celebrated, but if we're bad ones, well then we're never forgiven. How many black men are alive but are yet to start living? I don't want to change the topic, I want to ask y'all a question. Can we truly celebrate a season of emancipation if we can't imagine being held captive? Read a big obscene bell, half arachnid, the way they weave a web of lies and shrink us along before they suck us dry. If we're going to celebrate something, we got to at least understand the why. Otherwise, it's just a performative showcase where money-hungry merchants salivate at the thought of eating a plate of customer faith with a side of increased rates that we gladly pay. In the summer, capitalists become predators and naive black Beijings become prey. And I can't help but ask myself, where does black boy fit in that food chain? Cause we're seen as a threat, yet we aren't apex hunters. We can't devour entire demographics through democratic nonsense. We aren't monsters with sharp fangs designed to pierce the jugglers of indigenous cultures. We didn't evolve to hunt like colonizers. We bite only our own. Black boy is hunted by outsiders, then by cannibals right inside of his own home. It sometimes feels like our peace is rented in this humble abode, like God just doesn't live here anymore, like the house has been foreclosed and the doors sealed shut, like we tried to pay the rent with the sins we were told to repent, but we were short a couple bucks. There's no luck in selling a soul unless it has a cheap moral code. No profit in hearing the words of a prophet if you can't pocket the cash flow. It just feels like God just doesn't live here anymore. Not since the devil called this place home. And he's been making his presence fully known. Like how in the last 3 years I've seen so many suicides. CBC News broadcasts feel like a cult sacrifice. I've seen black boys worship fast money, praying to dollar signs at the shrine of galvanized and weed smoke. And I can't help but ask myself, when none of these shootings don't be committed by mulattoes or white folk? It's always some nappy hair black boy that look like me with dreadlocks on the afro. In the summer, we used to duck showers and raincoats. Now it is rain, more bullets than Rambo. El Nino got a snub nose tucked under a cloud of depression. In the summer, black boys are baptized by bullets. Because in a suffering society, crime becomes a new religion. And there's no exorcism for the demons the youth fears. Cause let me be real, young men under the age of 35 account for more than half the crime rate. They've been possessed by dirty money, greed, and hate. Married to the streets and the code, that's a dangerous double date. In the summer, black boys are baptized by bullets while a mother can only pray. And this summer, I just hope I don't become one of the saved.
Not only was that a live performance, they are being judged. And while that judging is ongoing, we're going to change the running order, which is in your programs. I hear them being opened. For over 25 years, the Frank Collymore Literary Endowment Committee membership has been an eclectic mix of individuals in fields ranging from education to entertainment to journalism, and includes practicing writers, arts managers, and literary critics. Through the FCLE, the Central Bank of Barbados fervently recognizes that writing is one of the most important platforms in which a people represents itself to itself and to the world at large. To deliver the report of the work of the committee for the literary year 2023, please welcome the new chair of the committee, alumni of the award itself. Her work has been widely anthologized, translated in Spanish and Polish, an arts educator for over 40 years. She has also produced academic writing and programming, and she forgot to share with me all of her theater productions that have been on this stage. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Yvonne Weeks.
How are you guys doing? Exciting evening, new things happening. It's my pleasure to present the annual report for 2023. Last year, we saw the retirement of Andy Tate as chair of the FCLE. I'm grateful to Andy for his mentorship during the previous years, which allowed me to take the reins relatively easily as the new chair of the FCLE. We also were joined in February by Wayne Jordan as a judge, but unfortunately, Wayne had to leave us because of pressing family engagement. We want you to know that we wish you well, Wayne. My pleasure now to introduce you to the members of the FCLE committee. Mr. Carla Applewaite, our wonderful MC for this evening, Mrs. Aisha Gibson-Gill, Dr. Andrew Armstrong, Mrs. Dana Jilks, Ms. Cara Price, Dr. Nicola Hunt, and Mr. Samuel Sawyer. Working with this committee has been an absolute pleasure. They have been extremely hardworking and bringing fresh and innovative perspectives to the work of the FCLE. I also want to make mention of our very capable and efficient secretary, Lafleur, who is the best secretary that one could ever wish for. This year, we did see a significant decrease in the number of entries. This is to be expected. Writing is not and ought not to be a hurried process. We still had too many entries in which only one or two poems, just a few pages of a short story, or previously published material were submitted. It's important that writers understand that the submission is to be comprehensive and unpublished work. The concerns and issues being explored in the manuscripts were riveting and compelling. However, the committee notes gaps in the prose entries, such as ambiguous motives, inauthentic female suffering, an inability to create relatable three-dimensional characters, and often too many inconsistencies in the plot. The poetry manuscripts often did not consider that single narrative that binds the work as a cohesive whole. Often the quality of poems was inconsistent, with collections showing brilliant pieces as well as unfinished verses. There was much telling, not enough showing, and moments where the poems might have been better served by simplicity rather than long-windedness. I would encourage playwrights to spend more time reading other plays, to see and to read and understand aspects of staging, narrative, character development, and dialogue. Ultimately, as writers, I want to encourage us to understand the importance of continuous rewriting, surrounding yourselves with critical readers, and then rewrite again and read. Edwidge Danticat, a world renowned for her award-winning books such as Brother, I'm Dying and The Harvesting of Bones, remains a voracious reader even while she's in the process of writing her work. We're excited to include the work of the spoken word artist. Orality has long been a clear indicator of languages, history, and culture. Indeed, the definition of literature has for centuries included oral literature, also known as orature, many of which has been transcribed. From ancient Greece to the late 19th century, rhetoric played a central role in Western education, in training orators, lawyers, counselors, historians, statesmen, and poets. Tonight you witness two of our best entries, and I do hope that next year we'll see many more participants in this genre. This year, the FCLE has expanded its mandate to provide practical support for Barbadian writers. Most of the winners of the FCLE have not been published, despite the outstanding and excellent writing. Other writers miss the mark even after entering year after year. Many years we've not been able to give a first prize, as the writing has not been of sufficient standing. While the writers have noteworthy potential and could do with direction, meet the standard to be awarded a prize, but are left with no support. The current FCLE committee approaches this situation with some concern. To this end, the committee is providing Arts Etc. with a developmental grant with the objective of supporting several of Arts Etc.'s initiatives for the coming year. Assist in facilitating the realization of a Barbadian anthology which includes the work of FCLE past winners, and enlist their services and resources in cultivating the potential of two of this year's finalists. With this manuscript developmental award, Arts Etc. will provide one-on-one consultations concerning editing, proofreading, and publication strategies that writers feel supported in this new dispensation. We are extremely grateful to Governor Greenwich for his endorsement of this proposal. I think the central bank deserves a hand. The committee also organized four workshops this year. The first two workshops were facilitated by our guest judge, Miss Elise Dilsworth, focused on professional development. She met with the shortlisted awardees individually and provided them consultation, not in her capacity as a consulting agent, but rather giving them professional assessment and the potential market and positioning of their work. Ms. Dilsworth also moderated an online interactive panel with our keynote, Dr. Anthony Joseph, and commissioning editor, Ms. Hannah Chukwu. Ms. Dilsworth will once again lend her eye this year, and we look forward to working with her in 2024. The other two workshops were a playwriting workshop conducted by Amanda Cumberbatch, lecturer at the University of the West Indies, and an editing workshop by our past president, Andy Tate. This morning, we had the pleasure of having a masterclass on sonnet writing, offered by Dr. Anthony Joseph, and we had a very exciting morning. So you can see that we've done many more workshops this year. I really want to encourage writers to take note of these workshops. This year, in addition to the workshop, we plan to showcase FCLE winning writers and spoken word artists in two events, a lunchtime concert, Stephen, are you here? And a free sunset concert. We wish to thank the Central Bank representative, Stephen Brathwaite, for these two initiatives. So please watch out for more information on our website and on the social media platforms. Our next workshop, write it down, is a Writing for Children workshop, which will take place virtually on January the 27th. And the facilitator is Joanne Hillhouse of Antigua. Please make sure you see the poster and the invite for that workshop. I congratulate all those writers who've been shortlisted this year. Do not give up on your dream to win the Collie. Do not give up on your dream to become a writer. Do not let your dream of seeing your work in print die. In a recent meeting with the new governor of the Central Bank, Dr. Greenwich, he expressed his support for the new direction of the FCLE. His main concern, and one which the committee fully understands, is that the FCLE must stand for excellence in all of its programming and highlight Central Bank's commitment to the literary landscape of Barbados. This is my first year as chair, and I must say it's been extremely rewarding and a fulfilling experience. As chair, I hope that we will continue the brand of excellence for the Central Bank and the community of writers. Thank you for your attention. Walk good.
Thank you, Yvonne. What an exciting season of the word. That was 2023, and we're all geared up for 2024, according to our chair. Our first spoken word competition, and we were very excited to have Lashana and Akeem share with us their works today. I'd like to take this opportunity to invite Kara and the chair to the stage, please. The spoken word competition, this is our first year, along with the main FCLE competition judges. We invited to our panel this evening Ms. Michelle Barrow, Samuel Sawyer, and Kara Price, adjudicated.
This is our Golden Globes, it's the Collies.
I have no jokes. Okay. The second place spoken word awardee in our inaugural competition is Lashana Griffith with Colorism 101. Step forward. Yes, yes. Congratulations, Lashana. And our winner this evening of the inaugural Frank Collymore Literary Endowment Spoken Word Competition, Black Boy, Akeem Chandler Prescott. Last year, Akeem was on this stage. I must note that he won an honorable mention for his literary contribution to the competition 2022. But congratulations.
As Yvonne did allude to earlier, this year we were so pleased to also have the innovation of the Manuscript Developmental Awards. In the tradition of the FCLE to always encourage, in the past we have noted works with honorable mention and encourage workshops and other advice for promising writers. This year, we are pleased to further assist and offer two manuscripts an editorial development prize so that they can continue their work with a professional editor. Ladies and gentlemen, the first manuscript developmental prize goes to Mr. Winston Farrell. Yes, he is. For his manuscript entitled From a Huckster's Tree, Poems to Wake the Villages. And our second manuscript developmental prize winner is Mr. Louis Harris. For his manuscript entitled States of Exile. Thank you, Yvonne and Cara. Writers and readers alike, we have reached the moment we have all been waiting for. The announcement of the Literary Writing Awardees for 2023. The who won what. This year, we awarded two works which were deemed remarkable in content with exceptional promise. As we look forward to more work from these noteworthy writers, we offer these commendations for their submissions. Our next readings will be excerpts from the shortlisted awarded finalists. In this tale set in bygone times, the personalities, relationships, and fates of a small range of characters absorb readers. Through the main character, both tragedy and promise tug at the reader's heartstrings. Plot is perhaps the element about which readers' responses might most diverge. Some will find it a confidently written story that is fully developed. Others would find a diminution in the unfolding and a suddenness in the closing. Language, however, is likely to evoke universal praise. This feels fresh and different. The beginning has a lyrical and ethereal quality, and there is magic in much of the word choice, phrasing, sentence structures, and rhythm. In this story, readers of older generations will find much that is familiar. Those of the younger generation will recognize several unchanging aspects of human life. Both categories of readers may, as one reader expresses it, love the sophisticated approach that presented the familiar while working the cliche. Ladies and gentlemen, Linda Dean, reading an excerpt on behalf of, we'll tell you later. Linda?
The Rainbow Window. The island rests like a gigantic prehistoric fish, tail fin stretching into the tempestuous waves of the Atlantic, head resting in the calm waters of the Caribbean Sea. On the hill at the cliff edge where the eye of the fish protrudes stands an ancient edifice. Solid walls of coral stone support a spire that soars taller than a myall tree and fades into the clouds until only the deep tone of a bell sounds from on high. Rafters hewn from a forest of timbers crisscross under the roof. The arched door is cut from tamarind wood, the pews carved from the trunks of mammy apple trees and are decked with mats woven from the aerial roots of a bearded fig tree. Beside the altar is a large clay pot containing scarlet poinsettia bush, representing the blood of their savior, and on top, a simple cross of bamboo. The pulpit is of the finest mahogany, polished and engraved with images of sea serpents, fire on their tongues. The people of the village, numbering no more than 200 or so, have made this their very own place of worship, though they have no idea when it was built, nor by whom, for it has stood longer than any living memory. The stained glass window, 10 feet above the altar, is enormous. It would take 30 little children holding hands to encircle the rim. 5,312 pieces of glass are secured in the lead frame, each one an exquisite disc the size of a penny coin. A rose window. It is round, though there is no pink. Instead, the colors of the rainbow display their brilliance in concentric circles. It is as if the people's God had flattened the universe by pressing his hand on the white light of the moon, pushing down into the indigo of the night sky, onto the blue of the sea, the green cane fields, the yellow of golden shower blooms, and out to the border of flamboyant blossoms in flaming red. The rainbow window is the people's heart and soul, their symbol of community survival and solidarity. Yet, all are aware that should even a spark from a cane fire find its way in, the age-old timber would catch and burn. The rainbow window melt in flames 10 times hotter than any from hell. The man in black shorts and a vest that might once have been white sits motionless, his back relaxed against a gravestone, his eyes alert, fixed on the window. Birdman, they call him, for his yard is a sanctuary to countless wood doves, cattle egrets, garlands, yellow breasts, and Dr. Booby hummingbirds, especially those that flap broken wings or limp after being trapped in chicken wire. He lives in the gully on the outskirts of the village. No woman, no child. Solitary and silent, his thoughts are private, his feelings unknown. Yet he is a man of the village, well-loved, without pity. He is their champion stick-licker, winning every competition, and it is to him that the people bring all essential items to be fixed, pan-carts and bicycles, pipes and drums, hoes and brooms loose on sticks. He it was who invented the gadget that exterminated mosquitoes, saving many from the ague of high fevers, chills, and shakes. And he is the custodian of their rainbow window. Every Sunday at sunrise, just after the early blackbird chorus, he straps himself into a harness of coconut husk ropes with a wooden bar on which he sits and a loop to secure his bucket filled with sparkling spring water. Agile as a green monkey, he winches himself to the top of the window and tugs on an elaborate pulley system that spirals him from the edge towards the center. With a cloth of the softest sea island cotton soaked in pure spring water from the bucket, he cleans the rainbow window, polishing the discs one by one until they are perfectly clear and sparkle like sunlight on seawater. At last, he reaches the center to caress the white moonstone. It is as if he hasn't seen the children sitting cross-legged and barefoot in a row below, sleepy, goggle-eyed, and open-mouthed. Perlita Jones, 13 and the tallest among them, clasps the back of her neck with both hands. And just as it's about to crack, he flicks water onto her upturned face, into her wild eye, bright as one of the polished discs. All the children shriek with glee as he showers them too, then fall silent as he cocks his head, raises his eyebrows. He knows what they are waiting for. Kicks against the wall of the church and swings upside down like a trapeze artist, soars and somersaults, lands on his toes as light as the breeze itself. The children cheer. More! We want more! Yes, Mr. Birdman, Perlita whispers. Please, fly high one more time. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. Our next reading is a collection of poems offering extended and meaningful treatment of a variety of subjects with noticeable language skill. The inspiration for and composition of poetry and the variable relationship between the poet and potential readers get the poet's attention. The conflicting realities of undervaluing of women, yet encouraging them to continue their species, sustain roles are underscored for our reconsideration. We are offered memories and musings on romantic relationships and their reverberations, and we are uplifted by celebrations of resilience and transcending darkness and defeat to achieve personal triumph. There is too lamentation for the failures of Caribbean post-colonial societies, but salutation of the creative defiance that keeps the souls of Antillean nations alive. Ultimately, the poet meditates on and challenges readers to perceive and respect the divinity in each person as the oneness of humanity. In this collection, there is an unmistakable didactism to which readers will respond in various ways. The same is true of the poet's vocabulary. At their best, the poems are characterized by striking imagery and language, and readers will be delighted by inspirational flashes of light, wonderfully fresh and caustic turns of phrase. Reading on behalf, I would like to invite Dr. Nicola Hunt.
Thank you so much. I'm especially grateful to the words of our keynote speaker, because I think they resonate really well with this particular poem. In particular, the poet's responsibility to be human and to speak truth. The name of the poem, Nocturne. Nighttime always closed in like an oversized jacket, with more than enough space to soak up tears, muffle curses, and shelter homeless dreams. Along the far-flung curve of night's cosmic bias, sparkle glimpses of the innate order that shaped my universe. Within its warm embrace, my blunders and approximations reemerged as potential, loosely tacked to the hem of time. In the solitude of its darkness, my world was more brightly lit. I was lauded for not disabling clients with too much enabling, credited for sowing trust among colleagues to reap fellowship, and befriended by those who used to begrudge my leadership. In its dark vastness, I was past continuous, infinity uncurbed, the embodiment of dreams that should never be deferred. I stuffed hope into every pocket to spend on promises made many mistakes ago, when I chased, blindfolded, after myself. I stitched up holes as they opened in seams of desire, for mates of intellectual promise whose morals erected walls between us. I pulled pains like base threads from memories of fickle friends and hot-headed partners with hard hands and daggers for tongues. I patched patience onto the lining of duty, daily worn ragged with mothering of parents in their second childhood, and the single-handed double parenting of two children who often faltered and fell, but rose to soar to every targeted height, while missing the fanfare of a father's voice to cheer each flight. Sunrise always reversed my changes, replaced blocks in my way, and cast me back like a broken doll upon the frowsy dump of day. After a rambling meditation through shards of dreams last night, I rolled over at dawn and stumbled forward, pushed by the urge to find that space in the jigsaw of service which only I could fill. I imagined moving on from this life, leaving in my wake an array of empty slots waiting in vain to be filled with my motifs, cantos, lyrics, and blogged ideas about conflicts and traumas. So I vowed to seek my purpose as a divine soul and be assertive when others discounted a skill, art, or service I'm eager to give. I swore that when sidelined by put-downs and setbacks, I would use those spots on life's margins, not as settlements, but as way stations, where my spirit can build more muscle by digging for soul lessons. Today, in the recruitment line, I felt the sun smack on my face, not with the usual sting of a slap, but with the warmth of a kiss. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicola. I would like to invite Mr. Elson Gaskin, the Deputy Governor, to please come to assist with the prize given, and to join him, Secretary of the Committee, Ms. LaFleur Cochran. Our third prize winner this year, Shack Shack, A Woman's Tongue Percussion, a collection of poems offering an extended and meaningful take on a variety of subjects. Ladies and gentlemen, Elizabeth Best. Elizabeth, unfortunately, is not here with us at this time. And if Nicola hasn't gone too far, would she mind accepting on her behalf? Thank you. Our second prize was endowed upon a work which was a tale set in bygone times. Taking the second prize of the Endowment Award for The Rainbow Window, Miss Christine Barrow. We're asking Linda to please accept on her behalf. I think it is noteworthy to share that Christine, in the 2019 competition, would have received an honorable mention for the 2016 competition. And here she is back again. Thank you both. Ladies and gentlemen, another round of applause for our awardees, even in absentia. As this evening comes to a close, we wish to offer our tokens of thanks. I'm going to ask Mr. Samuel Sawyer, fellow committee member, and I'd like to invite Dr. Joseph also to the stage.
Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment Committee, on this 26th iteration of its annual awards, we are happy to offer this token of appreciation to Dr. Anthony Joseph, not only for his excellence as a Caribbean literary icon, but for his consenting to come and deliver the keynote presentation at this year's award, and also for facilitating a masterclass this afternoon for 2 hours in the Frank Cullimore meeting room. Dr. Joseph, please enjoy this gift of Barbadian literature and Barbadian music.
Thank you, Sam. It's been a fantastic evening. Every year we try to do something different. This year we well wrapped it all into one. But to deliver the closing remarks and vote of thanks, I would like to invite dear friend and colleague, Mrs. Aisha Gibson Gill.
Good evening, everybody. I know you're ready to go, so I'm going to make this quick, but especially in the light of the last 4 very interesting years that you've lived through, this has been the roaring 20s. And the roaring isn't happy-go-lucky. We've lost a lot. And we're going to feel it for a long time, particularly those of us who either raise or steward children are seeing these effects. And one of the things that's been able to get so many of us through it is remembering what we're grateful for. So giving a vote of thanks is something that I'm very privileged and honored to do, because counting blessings is one way to balance out the constant body blows of getting up every day, opening a social media and being like, again? All the time so? So this evening I'd like to say very much thank you to the Central Bank of Barbados and its representative, the Deputy Governor, Mr. Elson Gaskin. Thank you so much for attending and for always being enthusiastic about attending, and particularly for reiterating the bank's support and endorsement, not just a rubber stamp, endorsement of the importance of what the Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment is about, what it does, what it plans to do, and for recognizing the developmental push that we have, and also how important rewarding and awarding and encouraging excellence is. So thank you. I want to say thank you. We're here because a committee came together and then broke off into subcommittees and other subcommittees and worked to get this put together. So we want to say thank you to our lovely MC for making sure that everything ran, Mr. Carl Applewhite. Thank you so much to the fellow committee members, not just for judging, for being so sensitive to, we really care about the writers and we really want the writing and the writers to get the best that they can. So thank you to Arts Etc. for constantly, you know, being in it, being there and saying, Barbadian writing, Barbadian writers, what are you doing? What are you gonna do? What can we do? So thank you to them. Thank you to thank you to the staff of the Frank Cullimore Hall, especially our representative on the committee from the bank, Mr. Stephen Brathwaite, for organizing this evening's proceedings. And of course, thank you to our keynote speaker, Dr. Anthony Joseph. I think you might have gotten a little bit of the impression from DeCarla how completely blown away our chair was when they met online during that panel discussion with the long-listed winners earlier this year, and you can see why. It's a voice, it's a presence, it's a poet. So thank you very much for your keynote address. And for distilling, I kept hearing all the time, oh, you have to read the work, you have to understand the way that he speaks about poetry. So for distilling that, it's about being human. It's something that I'm hoping the rest of us as writers and readers can constantly shift our own gaze. Like he said, it's a silent teaching, a deep teaching where it opens a portal to you shifting your perspective, which is what the poetry does. So thank you for that, because it should, now we should all shift our perspective when we're looking at the poems as judges, as readers, being human. So thank you very much for that. Thank you, of course, to our two finalists in the spoken word category for giving us a little razzle-dazzle this evening, and congratulations to them both. So thank you, Akeem. Thank you to LaShawna for taking yourself and the work seriously and coming and giving us a show. We want to say thank you also to our two readers, beautiful Linda, reading on behalf of Christine. Thank you for that awe-filled and awesome reading of The Rainbow Window, which really inspired the visuals that came to us. You read it with such beautiful sensitivity, so thank you. Thank you to Nicola, Dr. Hunt, for that very human reading of it. When she sat there, I was like, I read that manuscript multiple times. And that's not how I read that particular poem, so thank you for that. I want to say thank you to the National Cultural Foundation for the donation of those anthologies. If you know me, you know how fussy I am about those Arts Etc. Winning Words NIFCA anthologies. Barbadian writers are amazing, so I really hope that Dr. Josephs gets a chance to read them on that very short flight back to where he's coming from. And so thank you to those writers. Thank you to all of you for being here. Thank you for being readers. Thank you for being supporters of the Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment, not just the competition, but coming out, honoring our writers, honoring their words, and continue to read. Let people know, because you know that our writers are excellent. I want to say thank you to Glass Creation for those gorgeous trophies that you just saw. Beautiful, and as Linda intimated, heavy. I won't talk about why I like heavy things, but yes. So thank you for them. And I'm glad that he mentioned Bite In. I'm a little forward in generation, so I did not use Bite In, but I'm gonna say thank you for bringing up Bite In, because now it's time to go and get a bite from our caterers this evening. And they are MK Magnificent Dining Concepts, and our bar is Privilege. Our videographers this evening, Marnico Media, so thank you to them. And I started off talking about counting our blessings. It's because we are all feeling the loss. So thank you for taking the burden of representing our grief and our love for our Sonia and giving that beautiful tribute by reading her poem from her award-winning manuscript. Thank you so much, genuinely, genuinely, from the bottom of our heart. And thank you to Sonia.
Ladies and gentlemen, this brings a close to our evening. We really do hope you had a fantastic evening. We love starting with the Frank Cullimore Literary Endowment Awards in January. There's so much excitement for the year to come. As Aisha did say, don't go just yet. We have libation. So please join us on the terrace and do enjoy. Can the award winners and the committee members, however, make their way to the stage. Everyone else, we'll meet you outside in 5 minutes. Thank you. Thank you all for coming, and get home safely. Good night.